Give you an overall representation of the product development. It takes almost more than 10 years and several million hundreds of euro or dollars. It depends on which currency you consider. And the innovation will go through a different step. First, the proof of concept at the research level. Then it will go through pharmaceutical development in order to have a product which have good manufacturing quality. And then you have the two aspects of my talk, the preclinical trials and the clinical trials. However, those two steps are not really successive in the time. You should consider that those two steps are done partly successively and partly in parallel. As you can see on the slide, the preclinical steps will consider different preclinical trials on animal models. Some are mandatory before the first trial in human, and others will be done in parallel. On the clinical side, as you can see on the screen, it is not a successive flow of clinical trials. Some of them could be done also in parallel. And all the results that coming from these two steps in the product development will be joined to the market authorization dossier in order to allow the access of the innovation. Let me give you a focus on the preclinical trials. To start, I must admit that I'm not really a specialist of this part, so I will give you only overall the information. So there is some prerequisite before starting preclinical trials to ensure that the result of those preclinical trials are relevant before starting the clinical development. First prerequisite is scientific data. That means that you, before starting any preclinical trials, there should be a first proof of concept with product that was produced at the in-lab facilities. And what will be done during the preclinical trials, we will assess the efficacy and the safety by mimicking the foreseen administration in humans. The second prerequisite is what I consider as a technical aspect. Before starting the preclinical trials, we should ensure that the pre-industrial production is possible, because those preclinical trials should be done with the same formulation of the product that will be used later on in human. This provides us reliability of the result, because it is not a product that was produced in lab facility, but in a pre-industrial step. Third part that is really important to consider to any preclinical trials is also a regulatory constraint, because there is some standardization of the methodology involved in those trials, but also it will be necessary to obtain ethics approval in order to demonstrate that the assessment that will be done on those animals respect the animal rights. That means that the choice of the animal model is the good one, and when we can avoid using animal, it is done. The number of animal necessary very limited to the one really necessary to achieve steps, those trials, with a full reliability of the result. So those preclinical trials, as I show you before on the slide, there are some that are necessary before the first administration to human. Mostly those clinical trials should be done under good laboratory practices condition. That means the facility should have implemented quality management system to ensure that activities are done routinely and are under control, clearly monitored, and that at the end, the results provided by those trials are reliable. For those trials, preclinical trials, it should be chosen relevant species for the use of to test the pre-efficacy of product. And what is really important is that the same route of administration is tested during those trials. As I can I give you on this slide, there is four main trials to be done before the first administration to human. The first one is a primary pharmacology or potency test for vaccine. That means that with the product that was that resulting from pre-industrial process can still have an activity, a biological activities in the relevant species to confirm what was demonstrated at the lab level. Then we have two different safety studies. First one is acute and repeated toxicity in order to determine the maximum dose that could be tolerated by animals. And this will also constrain the maximum dose that could be tested later on in humans. So there is two tests to be done. The first one with only one dose, it is acute toxicity, which is assessed after one dose and which could be higher and higher. And then a repeated dose in order to be sure that there is no additive toxicity that that could emerge by several intake of the product. And it is important to consider that more than the animal should receive more administration than what is expected in human to ensure that we have maximized the capacity to demonstrate any safety issue before first administration in human. This study could be performed jointly with the secondary pharmacology study, during which an in-depth analysis of the safety will be done with the sacrifice and the necropsy of the animals and the analysis of every organs and biological systems to ensure that at tissue level there is no particular toxicity which may be the humans later on at risk of safety issues. What is also important before the first administration is to be sure that product could reach the target organ or the target system, biological system, to ensure it could be efficient. And sometimes it is difficult to make such studies because product could rapidly vanish in the overall animal. Those studies are the ones that are necessary before the first administration to human. And along the clinical development, there will be other assessment, preclinical assessment to be done, and that are required in order to ask for a market authorization. This is in general, and what I give you here should be considered by type of product, of course, because there is a difference between treatment, if it is a therapeutic one or a prophylactic one, and what is the mechanism of action of the product. So there is three kind of study to perform: the reproduction toxicity, the toxicity on embryo, fetuses, and newborn, and mutagenicity and carcinogenicity in animals. Those studies are pretty long. That's why they are not performed before the first administration, but along the clinical development. And if you need more information about what is necessary as a preclinical assessment of your product in the product development, I recommend you to read all the guidelines and the guidance that are provided by the ICH, the International Conference of Harmonization, which are considered by the European Medicinal Agency, the FDA, and other main competent authorities as standard to develop medicinal product for either human use or veterinary use. And to give you an overall of those guidelines, I give you in this slide all the guidelines that are provided by the ICH. And you could consider with the specificity of the product you decide to develop. For example, specific guideline for the anti-cancer, which could not be evaluated the same way as vaccine, for example. Let's move on to the clinical trial perspective. As you can see on this slide, which is an extract of the guideline E8 General Consideration for Clinical Trial, which is an efficacy guideline from the ICH. The clinical development plan will go through several phases of development. Along the phases of development, you can see that different type of study and the objective of study is done. It will start first with human pharmacology, then therapeutic exploration will be done, then confirm before the therapeutic use. And in fact, you should consider that when we cross, in fact, this line, this horizontal line, and this one, when we go from phase 3 to phase 4, here is those two lines represent the authorization market. And for each dot on this RAM correspond a clinical trials, which is led in, as described here. First, you set the objective of your trial, then you design it, you conduct the trial, you analyze the data, and then you report about the objective. Is it a success or not? And you go from phase to phases with several go-no-go depending on the safety or the efficacy assessed along those along this pathway. So I will also invite you to consider all the guidelines provided by the ICH, which are basis of the main information you should consider in product development. I will give you in two slides the shared feature of any of those clinical trials along the clinical development. First, the stakeholder. For each of those trials, you will have to identify a sponsor who will endorse the overall responsibility of the trial. It should ensure that the right people will take part to the project, to manage it, and to be sure that there is enough money to perform the trial, and also that the trial will comply with all ethical and regulatory requirements. The other main stakeholder is the investigator, who is the one who will lead the clinical investigation in a clinical investigational site. Of course, as you assess a product, there you should involve also the pharmacy or someone or a pharmacist in order to manage all the product aspect at a site. In a site. Then you will have a laboratory because you will have to ensure the participant safety, so you will have some biological monitoring to implement, and also in some cases you will have to the efficacy of your product will also need some particular lab analysis. Among the stakeholders, you have clinical research and safety organization. These are subcontracting parties which are very specialized in clinical research, and they will handle some monitoring activities and also the data management and potentially the data analysis and the safety reporting authorities. Of course, participants are mandatory to reach the objective, because without participants, you can't do any assessment of the safety and the efficacy of the product. And at least there should be also granting parties, because performing clinical trials cost a lot. It is not important not to forget them. Then you will have to implement a different type of study document. The main one is the protocol, which will describe what is your objective, how you consider to reach it, how the investigation should be performed, which are the responsibility of the investigator. It is the core document for a clinical trial, and it will be assessed to get the authorization to start the trial. Then you will have the information and consent document that will be used to inform the participant in order to obtain their consent to participate in the study. Then you have operational manual, of course, because there will be many expertise involved and many specialists involved in the trial, so you will have to coordinate it and to standardize the relation among those people. Then you have the case report form. This is the document in which the study data will be collected. It used to be a paper one, but now it is more and more done electronically. Then you have the statistical analysis. The second core, I would say, document, because you should describe in advance how you will analyze the data, how you will replace some data if they are not available, and in order to give reliability to your study result. And at the end, you will write a study report, because you should conclude about your objective, and you will have to give those conclusions to authorities. And all those documents, except I would say the operational manual, all the other documents are really mandatory and will be joined to the market authorization request. That's why it is really important to implement them very carefully for each trial. The other shared feature of any clinical trials is the compliance. That means that before including participants and administer them the investigational product, your innovation, you will have to get ethics approval, competent health authority authorization, but also data protection agency registration approval or authorization, depending on the regulation applicable in the country where the trial is performed. But also you will have to subscribe an insurance to cover the potential harm that could experience the participant during their contribution to the clinical trial. And there is two other aspects to consider. The first one, which is an ethical one, but which is very familiar to people from the research institute, is that the study should be registered in specific databases in order to get public information about the research. You may not comply to ethical requirement or compliance that your research institute has given to the WHO. And of course, compliance, I said on this slide, the main one, but it is important that you make sure that there is no other requirement that your clinical trial should fulfill before starting. For example, if your product is a genetically modified organism, there will be additional authorization to get. So it is important to consider what is your product, what are the regulatory requirement related to it before starting conception of your clinical trial. The other shared features are the investigational product that should be provided for free for the participant, and which will have a specific labeling and a specific accountability and sometimes specific temperature record. And then today it's not possible to implement clinical trial without considering risk-based monitoring on several aspects, such as participant inclusion, data collection, investigational medicinal product management, biobank management, and safety monitoring. What is really important to consider for each trial, you should have defined objective. You should be selective. Then you will have to have defined outcome, endpoint, surrogate endpoints, which makes sense on a clinical point of view. Then you will define the participant population with criteria. You will set investigation procedures, and you may have to provide specific material for the assessment. And core of any trial is to define a design in order to limit the bias of assessment. What is really important is sometimes to consider comparison, randomization, and blinding procedures. With this slide, I will give you a comparative overview of all the three phases we see previously on the diagram from the ICH-8 guideline. So I make a distinction between the main objective for medicine and for vaccine, because there is some difference. During the phase one, as you can see, for medicine, it is mostly a question of pharmacology, including safety, whereas for vaccine, it is not really possible to perform a pharmacology PK, PD test for vaccine. So it is mainly focused on safety with a dose escalation. The most at-risk phases in a clinical development is really the phase one trial, because it is the first administration to human after the preclinical trial. And there is another phase which is very at risk for a startup, I would say, or any industrial lab, industrial pharmaceutical company, is the phase three, because those phase three trials are confirmatory trials upon which there will be or not a market authorization request to health authorities. As you can see on this slide, the number of participants increase from phases to phases, and the market authorization is not the end of the assessment of safety and efficacy of a product, because there is what is said phase four step, during which the efficacy and the safety could still be assessed in real life and in liaison with the RMP, which is the risk management plan, could be necessary to provide in the market authorization dossier. Now we'll give you a short overview of specific feature of each of those two phases. So the phase one, as I said, correspond to the first in human trial. It is always done on a sequential design, mainly in healthy volunteers, except for, of course, product in cancerology. And it is done under very restrictive conditions. Impose the sponsor to operate those phase one trials in specific care units with immediate access to emergency unit in case of acute, unforeseeable safety issues. And there should be also a data safety monitoring board organized by the sponsor to ensure an independent evaluation of the safety before getting to the next higher dose, and to review all the safety information during the volunteer follow-up. And I give you on the right side of the slide schematic representation of an escalation dose of the assessment of the product. But you should also consider that within each dose, we can't administer the product to all the participants at the same time. It should be done sequentially in order to minimize the number of subjects at risk of unforeseeable acute safety issues. And at all steps, you should do a balance between the interest of continuing the assessment versus the risk to which the volunteer are exposed to. Concerning the phase two trial-specific features, those trials can be done either in mono, in one site, or in several sites. They are still done mostly in hospitals facilities. It will be the phase where the first efficacy comparison will be done product, with the two conditions I set on the slide. This phase will allow to detect very frequent adverse reaction, and such trials can be repeated in very strictly selected population. At this stage, you could consider to test, to assess in different population, for example, young adult versus elderly one, or you could also do a de-escalation of the age of the participant in order to assess, in fact, the product in the younger one, which could be, in fact, the real target of your product. For example, if you have a vaccine, you will first assess your vaccine in adult, and then progressively you will de-escalate the age of the population participating in the study until you reach the final target population, which are probably the babies less than 1 year old. And for those trials, there will be also a data safety monitoring board to be implemented by the sponsor with the same objective as in phase one to ensure the safety of implementing the following dose or the following group of individuals. Concerning the phase three trials, special features, as I said, it is the target one, the one that is really mandatory before seeking the authorization for market access. Those trials are mainly international multicentric studies in order to achieve the inclusion target. It was set in the table more than 100 individuals in order to ensure the power of the study results. Those investigations are done in the field. That means they are not only located in hospital. It could be done also in medical center or at home. It should be as close as possible as what will be done in the real life. It will allow detection of common to less frequent adverse reaction and serious adverse reaction. The selection of people will be strict, but less strict than the previous phases in order to be as much as representative as a target population which will receive the product after the market authorization. And concerning the DSMB, there will be a slight change in this mission. The first one is the same, to review the safety during the participant follow-up. But what is really important is that they could assess through interim analysis of the collected data, they could assess the relevancy to continue or not the study, the trial. Because sometimes upon those interim analysis, these DSMB could recommend to stop the trial because it seems that we won't reach the target. We won't be able, with the remaining people to be assessed, that the product is efficient. Or so it is futile to pursue the trial in this situation and to put people at risk of receiving a product that won't access to the market later on. And on the other side, they could also decide to stop a clinical trial if there is a strong evidence that product is efficient, so it is not necessary to continue the trial. And in that case, it would be possible to seek a market authorization in advance in the clinical development. Sometimes I must admit that in outbreak situation, those phase three trials may not be fully completed before the people in real life could be administered the product, because it is important, the benefit from a rapid access to the innovation overcome, in fact, the risk of waiting of a full completion of the phase three trial. I give you on this slide several kind of design that could be used for those trials. I select on the slide only conservative design, but there is also adaptive ones. You should seek expertise from a methodologist in order to be sure that what you set for such an evaluation is very relevant and adapted to your product. As I said before, there are several guidelines that you may have to consider to implement clinical trials. They are all related to efficacy among the ICH guidelines. And here is my conclusion. I have two take-home messages. The first one is that product development is rather complex and under strong regulatory constraints. So it is important to seek the expertise to guide you and to operate the clinical trial and to do it by anticipation and in compliance with the constraint. And the second take-home message is that preclinical and clinical steps are very intricate, and they take time. So it is really important to anticipate and to write in advance what is the product development plan with all those steps in order to ensure that you will be able to apply for market authorization, but also to do it in the fastest way as possible. And of course, what is important in this development plan is to set go-no-go criteria, because it is not mindless to keep going as you can't. The target of the market authorization is not maybe reachable.